I want to read to you something Kyle Shanahan said out of his own mouth.
Okay.
Kyle Shanahan said this a year ago to Ed Werder. Quote, in reference to Trey Lance, quote, he's not Lamar Jackson. Trey is a quarterback who has the ability to run. But to just line him up and run him, I mean, the game's too physical. That's what Kyle Shanahan said. So a year later, we see how we use Trey Lance. We see what happened. What do you think of the Trey Lance story?
Well, I think Kyle Shanahan's a visionary. You know, he's a visionary. He saw it because he's totally right on that quote.
Right.
You know, this goes back to week one. Forget yesterday for a second. Let's get into week one. That was my big takeaway that was, you know, and I love Kyle Shanahan. I think he's a terrific coach. Heck, you and I both predicted that Kyle Shanahan's football team would win the Super Bowl. So on some level, we were giving him some acknowledgement that this guy is, you know, it's not like he's some scrub. He's a top tier NFL coach, but I didn't understand the usage of Trey in the Arizona game. I said it, and I didn't understand the usage of Trey in the first game. And I said it, immediately I get the same pushback that probably everybody else who would say something like that would get. Oh, it's football. Hey, it's a rough game. Guy, you can get hurt anyway. You could get hurt in practice. You could get hurt standing on the sidelines. You get these people who kind of just get, you know, dug in on their position. But to me, there's a huge difference between, hey, you know what? I don't think we need Jimmy Garoppolo anymore. I think we need somebody who has some mobility. That's just noticing what's around you. That's just noticing that the Josh Allens and the Patrick Mahomeses and the Deshaun Watsons are the future of the NFL. And that if you're going to compete for a Super Bowl in the NFL that those players reside in, I don't know, maybe it would help to have a player who was a little bit more versatile, had a little bit more high level athleticism. So I bought into that and I still buy into that. And to me, that was the reasoning behind going for Trey Lance. But then to get him in there and to just run him between the tackles recklessly this is exactly what was going to come. And whether it was going to come in game two, game 12, in a way, I'm happy. It sounds terrible because I'm not rooting for injury. And Trey's a good kid and I'm rooting for good things for him. But in a way, I'm kind of glad it happened earlier than later, because it's a loud statement to everybody who watched it that it ain't a sustainable plan. I don't care whose idea it was, who else in the league does it. It's not a sustainable plan running your quarterback between the tackles against NFL caliber defenses.
And so that's where I'm coming from. Kyle's going to try to sell it as like, this is how I had to use Trey. But that's not true, because we saw Kyle call a very smart game for Trey against the Texans. Jimmy wasn't there. He was hurt. There was no backup. Kyle called a great game. Trey executed it and they won. Then they come in year two after a full offseason, and you're telling me this is how you have to use Trey. It's not like, yeah, sure, run him. But you're going to run him like a steady diet early in the game when you don't have to. They could have beaten the Seahawks with Trey Lance handing off 50 times and throwing 10 passes. Instead, he was going to be the leading rusher for like the third time in four starts. He was the leading rusher against Arizona. He was the leading rusher in Chicago. Why? To me, that's negligence at best. And sabotage at worst. It's okay to run your quarterback, but that's running him into the ground. And you have to wonder, why was Kyle so cavalier about that?
I mean, there's one number that the only number you need to know from yesterday is the number three. Trey Lance had three pass attempts. Trey Lance had three rushing attempts. I mean, the end of the game, Jimmy wound up with 21 pass attempts. So if Trey had been in there, would it have been 21 pass attempts for Trey and 21 carries? I mean that's not sustainable. Nobody in the history of the NFL has ever sustained that, ever.
Trey was getting like 13 carries a game or so. He was on pace to be running the ball like a running back, more than the other running backs on the team. And why do you ask Trey Lance to run on 2nd and 8 in the second quarter when you're winning and your running backs are running well? It's not necessary. So what you're saying is you don't care if your quarterback gets hurt. because you have to acknowledge that there's a way bigger risk of him getting hurt running between the tackles and staying in the pocket. All the rules protect a quarterback. Tom Brady is going to could play until he's 50 years old if he wanted to, because the rules protect quarterbacks in the pocket. Once you do that, you're a running back, and all of Kyle's running backs get hurt. I'm going to try to calm down.
Your dad made the best point, I thought, on Twitter when he said, "Hey, look, paraphrasing a little bit, but you know, if this was a key sequence in the fourth quarter and the game was on the line and you needed to put the game away and you ran Trey up the middle because you needed that first down to ice the game, man, that's one thing. You voluntarily threw him into the defensive line in the second quarter. And all I would say is risk versus reward. Right. What was the reward? What's the reward for running your quarterback between the tackles? Do you expect that he's going to bust one and take it the distance?
Probably not.
Right. Yeah. So what?
You might get 4 yards, right? It's what he's averaging, 4 or 5 yards a carry.
Right. So risk reward. I mean, I said this in the Arizona game. If you looked at there were 16 runs in the Arizona start last year. Mm-hmm. I think 9 might have been designed and 7 were scrambles or the opposite. On the scrambles, Trey averaged like 13.5 yards a carry and he got hit like a third of the time. On the runs, he averaged 3.2 yards per carry and got hit every single time. So why would you volunteer hits on your quarterback when you're sitting in a coaching room with a defensive coordinator like D'Amico, who could tell you that maybe his goal for Sunday is to get 10 hits on Geno Smith?
Right.
Right. And you're going to volunteer 9 on your quarterback for no reason at all? You could have literally perfect pass protection the entire game, and you're going to volunteer 9 hits on your quarterback? I mean, I explain to me what I don't know, because I don't understand that.
Well, here's what, when I asked the question after the game, I would say, like, I asked, why did you call that in that situation? And he made fun of me, like, well, would it have been better if I called it on 2nd and 4? Well, frankly, yes. Because you might have gotten a first down if you called it on 2nd and 4. Here's my thing. He called a quarterback draw on 3rd and 6 on the first drive, and it worked. He got 7 yards, first down. I like that call. You're going against a substitute, lighter defense that's expecting a pass, probably a light box, probably 5-6 in the box, 2 safeties back. A quarterback draw, I mean, you're not going to get hit hard. That's a good call. On 2nd and 8, you're not getting a first down. You're not getting a touchdown. You might get 4 yards, but what is the reward there? When we watched Russell Wilson with the Seahawks for years, you knew he'd keep it maybe once a game, but you didn't know when it was going to happen, and it was going to be for a touchdown or a key first down in the fourth quarter. Not 2nd and 8.
And it was almost always on bootlegs or outside. The line of demarcation is inside or outside the tackle box. You want to run your quarterback outside the tackle box, I'm all for it. I'm really all for it. Get to the edges, spread teams wide, run the ball like crazy, play action pass, bootleg off of it. Now you got Trey in open spaces against one defender, make a move, that kind of thing. I totally get it. To run him up the middle on a 3-4 football team that has Al Woods at 350 pounds in the middle. The other two guys are houses. Their 3-4 are just, there's a lot of big bodies in there. And then the other thing is I've been trying to figure out in my head, who does Trey remind me of when I'm watching him? Is who is it that he reminds me of? And the guy that he reminds me of is William Floyd. And I say that because William Floyd was a high effort between the tackles fullback, but his constant second and third effort and his refusal to go down exposed his legs to the defense. And it was just a matter of time before somebody ripped up his ACL. Sure enough, Saints, Niners at Candlestick, exact play I'm talking about, second effort, twisting, turning, somebody hit him the wrong way, tears the ACL, done for the year, career never the same. And
it's lucky that Trey Lance didn't tear his ACL. How about that for a silver lining? Could have been his knee.
I mean, now we've seen Dak come back from the ankle and he looks all right. But when you can't expose your legs to the defense. I don't care if you're 25 pounds heavier and 3 inches shorter and you have really, really stout legs. You can't expose your legs to the defense and allow that. It's just not sustainable. So I get the idea of having a mobile quarterback. I get the idea of using that mobile quarterback. I don't get the idea of quarterback power, quarterback draws up the middle with a quarterback and letting him push the pile with his head and exposing his legs. This could have happened in camp. It could have happened in the preseason. It was destined to happen and happen soon. And sure enough, week two.
I also don't get Kyle just totally giving up on running Trey to the perimeter. Like, they act like he's slow. He's not slow. Josh Allen runs a 4.75, and the Bills get him on the perimeter routinely. Why can't the Niners do that? He has to run between the tackles? No, I don't think so. I think the Niners haven't figured out how to get him on the perimeter. And I think that's, again, Kyle tried to act like this whole year of putting Trey on the shelf was the best way to develop him, when I think it actually did him a disservice. He was inexperienced. The pandemic took away a year from him. He needed reps. And now you put him in a situation where he was on the bench for 2 years. I don't think that did him any favors. And now he's in a situation where he's going to be on the bench for 3 years, coming off a serious injury. I feel bad for him. We're going to talk about his future in a minute. Anything else you want to say about the mismanagement of Trey?
Well, I mean, don't tell me Josh Allen. I've watched the Bills. They don't use Josh Allen this way, in this manner, this often. So I'd like to know who's the comp? Who's the quarterback that has had a lengthy, productive career? Because that's what I'm sure Kyle wanted for Trey Lance. Who's the quarterback who's had a lengthy, productive career running between the tackles? Go ahead.
That much. 14 times a game.
Yeah, I'd love to hear it. I'd love to know. Can't picture anybody. Can't envision it. And this is going to be, unfortunately, Kyle lost a lot of support in the last 24 hours. A lot.